I had a dream. It was the most extraordinary dream. And I'm considering, how in the world can I convey this to the world? Because it was like a dream of enlightenment. I saw, experienced the whole situation here and the freedom from it. Freedom from the flesh. Freedom from the flesh. I experienced it. And I asked the Holy Spirit, how can I say anything about this that is not going to seem completely blasphemous? And the truth is that when you speak the truth in this world, the world hates you. The world hates it. Absolutely hates it, because it's... Nevertheless, even though it seems completely blasphemous, the more truthful something is, the more blasphemous the world will think it is. It still needs to be conveyed, but conveyed spirit to spirit. What we are is spirit. We are not flesh. We're not human beings at all. We are not. And that is crucial. Those who consider themselves to be human beings will take this as utter blasphemy and will not be able to handle it, or it will not help them. But we, I assure you, we are spirit. We are spirit. What our experiencing of spirit is not through the body, is not through the brain and the senses. Absolutely not. The brain and the senses, we call the human being, flesh, human being. That literally can never be inspired. Okay. It is a truism, it is a truth to say that spirit cannot inspire humanity. Humanity is inherently uninspirable. And we are waiting for inspiration. It will never come. You cannot be inspired through the senses and the brain and the nervous system, the flesh. You cannot. Absolutely cannot. It is as if you are on like a flat piece of paper trying to be inspired in a flat way, where a spirit has infinite depth and breadth, endless breadth and depth to it. There is simply no way that the flesh can experience the spirit. Absolutely no way. The good news is, doesn't have to. That's the great news. So, I cannot inspire you. Nobody can inspire you. And in fact, the human race has never been inspired. And this is the part that people will feel blasphemous and get upset about. The human race has never been inspired. And it never will be inspired. All the stuff the human race is dealing with is dispiriting. It's dispiriting. In fact, I have said before that God is not even aware of this nothingness that's going on. Not even paying any attention to it. Spirit doesn't pay any attention to it. But because some spirits, because we are, think we're trapped narrating this nonsense, Spirit does address it and say, look, it's nothing. You can't inspire it. Give up trying to inspire it. Stop trying to inspire it. See, Spirit is trying to inspire humanity, and it's futile, absolutely futile. And what Spirit needs to hear is, Spirit doesn't need to inspire humanity. This is the key point. Say, I don't need to inspire humanity. And it's incredible freedom and liberation from that. I don't need to inspire humanity. Humanity is uninspirable. So, in this dream, I asked Spirit, how can I stop trying to narrate this humanity and feel sucked into this flatness where I'm completely unaware of my complete expansiveness as Spirit? And I was shown something. And this something is, humanity is going, it was a chant like from humanity going, oh, he. I said, who's this he? And Spirit said, they're claiming to be inspired by this He said, oh, he's so wonderful. He is. And that's what sucks you into. You think, oh, they're getting inspired. Someone is inspiring. Somehow they're getting a source of inspiration. And you think, huh, what is this source of inspiration? Let me try and find out. You get sucked into trying to inspire humanity that way. But it's a pretense. It is a pretense. They're making their inspiration up. They say, he inspired me, or God, you know, they call, God inspired me, he inspired me. And Spirit says, huh? You know, what are you talking about? Well, what? There's no inspiration there. What are you talking about? So Spirit told me, get on the opposite side, distance yourself from that, and calm down. So you don't hear this chant. It's like a black hole. It's like sucking, like a vacuum, sucking Spirit into identifying with the flesh. His flesh is saying, he inspired me. He told me this. He is so wonderful. He is so wonderful. You hear all these talks about, he is so wonderful. What is this he? What is this he that's so wonderful? And they say, well, it's a source of our inspiration. I say, what inspiration? What are you talking about? There's no inspiration. Humanity doesn't have any inspiration. It's dispirited. And the fact is that what is humanity? It's the attempt of Spirit to annihilate itself. And since it's a symbol of it. Since Spirit cannot annihilate itself, it symbolizes a precursor to the annihilation. And this is called humanity. So the purpose of humanity is really to be dispirited. Dispirited. To continually get depressed and run down and suffer loss and trauma, etc. And all the while, though, it claimed that they're very motivated and inspired to do this. You see, that's what they're doing. When they're talking about humanity, talking about being inspired, they're really inspired to what? Continue on with this nonsense. It's not true inspiration. Inspiration means in spirit. Being in spirit. Humanity is never in spirit. It's never been in spirit. It's impossible for the body to be in spirit. That is why the great teachers and gurus, they come to this world and they say that they don't even identify with the body mind at all. They have zero identification with it. They're not inspiring their body. The body mind, the brain, the nervous system and senses cannot be inspired. They cannot be in spirit. Never can. So it's futile. If that's the goal people have, it's futile. Absolutely futile. We don't need to, though. We don't need that to happen. Because again, humanity, all this is simply Spirit's attempt to annihilate itself and through acceptance of the annihilation, be reborn as a new spirit, this time as prime creator of a new creation. That is what Spirit is trying to do. So in humanity is just a symbolization of a precursor. Before the annihilation happens, Spirit says this is how it happens. First, Spirit becomes humanity. And then it's annihilated. See, it's the step just before annihilation. So how can humanity be inspired when what they are is just one step away from total annihilation of spirit? So we are spirit. We're not bodies. We're not flesh. And our awareness is 360 degrees. It is totally open, like complete open space, as it were. And our experiencing is super rich and super beautiful. And it is not in the slightest bit bound by the brain and the senses. So if any of us can hear this, and consider it, guaranteed that you are so far beyond the curve that nobody can even measure how far beyond the curve you are. And you are very close to actually waking up and realizing that you are spirit. Which is a great thing, because the attempt on Spirit to inspire humanity causes Spirit to feel like suffocation, like it's trapped in some piece of film, as it were. Like it's trapped, like movie film. Like it's actually in the movie film, and it's completely flat. It loses all sense of spiritual depth and experiencing, and it loses a sense of itself. It doesn't have the sense of itself. It's horrible, absolutely horrible. So the problem is spirit is trying to inspire humanity. That is literally the problem. And the answer, paradoxically, is spirit needs to stop trying to inspire humanity. That is the answer to the whole thing, which is, of course, backwards to the way we're used to thinking, completely backwards to how we're used to thinking. We keep saying, Jesus, please come. You need to inspire us. You need to inspire us. No, it's the opposite. We need to say, let's stop trying to inspire humanity. Jesus, help me stop trying to inspire humanity. It's like that. Spirit, help me stop trying to inspire humanity. Teach me how to stop trying to inspire humanity. And if you're honest, you look at humanity and you realize they're not inspired. They're uninspired. If you really want to tack a name to humanity, you can say it's uninspired. And that's why we keep thinking, my gosh, this poor humanity, they need to be inspired. Let me help them. You know, that spirit looks at humanity and says, they're so uninspired that I can inspire them. No. It's not possible. So salvation really comes when spirit gives up its attempt to inspire humanity. That is when it comes. And humanity is ceaselessly pretending like they're begging for a savior, and they keep also pretending that they're getting all this inspiration, and they're very open to inspiration. That is a pretense. It's the trap. It's the scam. Humanity is not the slightest bit open to inspiration. It's open to despiriting. Being dispirited, being deceived and dispirited. And it's really nothing at all. Humanity is nothing at all. Again, it's just imaginary, hypothetical scenario, a simulation of loss as a precursor, as a training exercise for spirit to suffer complete annihilation so that it can be reborn, magically reborn, resurrected as a new spirit with a new creation, it being the prime creator. So, the reason why spirit remains stuck, like on flypaper, imagine flypaper. Say humanity is really just flypaper. Spiritual flypaper is what it is. And spirit gets too close to it and says, maybe they want help, let me try to help. And then it sticks to the flypaper. It says, I can't get free, I'm stuck. That's what it's like. Spiritual flypaper. So getting unstuck is the key. And I was asking spirit, I woke from this dream, and I was asking spirit, kind of a semi-dream state, okay, what do we do here? What do we do? How do I get free of this? And spirit said, you need to first get some distance from it so you don't keep hearing this, he, that. It's kind of like, you know, the chant for the hero to show up. It's kind of like that thing. It's humanity saying, we're so ready for the Savior to come. You know, that kind of thing. That's the trap. That is the trap. There is no Savior for humanity. See, this is the thing, that the reason why you're still stuck is you don't hear this type of teaching, because it's not given out here. Who's willing to give out this type of teaching? It's, of course, the world will hate you if you do that. So there is no salvation for humanity. That is a fact. Never has been and never will be. And then we say, well, what about the saviors that have been here? They didn't come to save humanity. They came to save spirit from humanity. Okay? They came to save spirit from humanity. Humanity, again, is just a training exercise. That's all it is. Spirit set up this training exercise to try and annihilate itself. Not only that, try to accept its annihilation. Try to learn how to accept, be 100% accepting of their own annihilation, as if that were possible. But of course, God created spirit, and so spirit didn't create itself. So what spirit is not of its own making. So God made spirit invulnerable, indestructible, eternal life. So spirit cannot annihilate itself. cannot. So humanity cannot be saved. And in giving up your attempt to save humanity, you yourself will then be free. You'll suddenly, oh my gosh, I'm spirit. And I have this awareness of vision of all this vastness, beautiful vastness that spontaneously fills with anything I want. My gosh, it's so much better than being stuck to flypaper, being stuck to the flypaper of humanity. The world will say, oh, he's so wonderful. Oh, he is so inspirational. He's so inspired me. He's so helpful. He's this. This is the chant, of course, from the world. And spirit says, wow, there's some other source of inspiration, some other spirit. I don't know. What is this other spirit? No. They're all just making this up. They're not inspired at all. They're just pretending to be inspired. But it's completely flat. It's just that's the lure. You know how flowers and, you know, the nature has all these lures that lure the insect into them and catch them or something, or stick them or whatever. And that's the lure. Existence has this lure saying they're being inspired by something. And spirit says, wow, let me check this out. And I say, wow, humanity's still so uninspired, and yet they say they're being inspired. Who's doing the inspiring? Maybe I can help out a little bit, you know, I should be able to help. No, it's a trap. Humanity is literally a trap. It is a trap. And humanity goes around saying, we're so proud, so many inspirational sources of inspiration we have. And I say, really? You look around humanity as we do every day, I don't find a single inspired bit of inspiration here at all. Cannot find it. The only ones are the great teachers and gurus, and of course they say that they're not identified with the body at all. It's not their body, not their humanity that's inspired at all. They say that it's spirit, that there's spirit here showing us how to get free. Again, freedom comes from spirit giving up the attempt to inspire humanity. See, that is the complete turnaround, isn't it? What we're trying to do is we're trying to inspire humanity. That is the problem. I can speak from my own experience, that most definitely is the problem. I thought I could come here to inspire humanity. I tried so hard, what did I end up with? Total depression. Because that's the direction that humanity is actually geared towards, is total annihilation. And so when you try to find the source of inspiration humanity wants, what you end up finding is total mental chaos. That is literally what they're seeking for. All this other stuff is a charade. Like, oh, we want to be saved. Humanity says, oh, please save us. You know, all their pretense. What humanity is really about is a training exercise to annihilate spirit, for spirit to annihilate itself. And humanity didn't set itself up. Spirit set it up. It's spirit's training exercise. And of course, God pays no attention to this training exercise whatsoever. We keep thinking that God is profoundly aware and focused on humanity. Nothing could be further from the truth. God pays no attention whatsoever to spirit's training exercise. It doesn't even exist to God. There's no judgment upon it. God's aware that spirit is engaged in this training exercise, but God overlooks it entirely. Overlooks it entirely. So again, these types of teachings, I tell spirit, I said, nobody will listen to this, spirit, and if they do, they'll hate it. And I said, well, I'll say it anyway. What you want me to say? But most people here, they want to be liked in the world, so they won't tell the truth. Most people here, they want to inspire others, so they won't tell the truth. They won't admit that they cannot inspire anyone here. See, I can tell you that. I cannot inspire anybody. It's impossible. Absolutely impossible. I cannot inspire a single human being. Never, never. So it's giving up our attempt to inspire humanity that we realize our freedom from that flypaper. Say, we have wings again. We can fly again. We're We're in unbounded space, and everything spontaneously manifests for me. So I told Spirit, look, if you help me out, I will pass this on, but I'm not passing it on to humanity. I'm passing it on to those who have spiritual awareness. Spiritual awareness means awareness that one is spirit. At least at some level, there's a feeling like I'm not really this body. Even though we're acting like it, there's spirit saying, hey, I'm stuck. I'm stuck to this flypaper. I don't like it. I'm stuck here. A feeling of being stuck here is probably a good way to put it. Feeling like I'm just feel very stuck in a place I don't want to be stuck in. That's spirit. And so I'm talking to spirit. I'm passing this on from the freedom of spirit I experienced last night. I experienced the freedom of spirit. And ask spirit, hey, what's the problem? How do we get free? And this is the what I was shown. And I was explained to me as best I can. Maybe at some point I'll have even more clarity on this, probably. We are spirit. We are free. We are as God, I am as God created me. I am spirit, I am free. I am as God created me. And God did not create humanity, did not create spirit to try and inspire humanity, did not give spirit the job of inspiring humanity. Again, humanity, the fact is the body is an inert, neutral thing. It has no opinions of its own or concepts or ideas whatsoever, zero. Form doesn't have any intrinsic life to it at all. So spirit is simply, again, wants to be prime creator. And that means that it wants to change reality, which is impossible. And so how does it experience being prime creator? It experiences a scenario where it seems possible that it can obtain this. How? Well, spirit would have to be annihilated. It'd have to be because since it can't change what it is at all, can't change what it is would have to just be gone completely. And then somehow resurrected from this annihilation as a new spirit. And then it could make its own rules, its own creation. So it is trying to, mind is presenting a scenario where spirit can do this. And this humanity, this bodies, these forms that are vulnerable to loss and decay and being dying, spirit is identifying with this play of humanity as a training exercise to learn how to be annihilated. The spirit doesn't, nothing in reality knows how to be annihilated. So, but mind tells spirit it can learn how to be annihilated. So spirit is identifying with this and this play, and eventually spirit says, "Wow, I'm feeling so stuck here. I don't like this. I want to be free. But how do I need to inspire humanity to give up this game? No. Humanity is not the one engaging in the game. It's spirit. Humanity did not make itself. Humanity didn't give itself its purpose. Spirit gave humanity its purpose." And again, humanity is just neutral. The bodies are neutral. Forms are neutral. They don't have any life of their own. They don't have any purpose. Bodies didn't make themselves and say, I made myself to be a training exercise for the annihilation of spirit. No. Spirit is imagining all this. It's a simulation. It's a simulation. So humanity of itself is nothing. It's an imaginary simulation. So we don't need to inspire it. It doesn't need to be saved. Humanity doesn't need to be saved. The human quote-unquote being doesn't need to be saved. Spirit needs to get free of that flypaper. Stop trying to inspire humanity. Stop trying to use humanity for any purpose. Let it go. So these clarifications are very important right now, because spirit is actually trying to inspire humanity now. And the more it tries, the worse it gets, the more stuck it gets. And the more stuck it gets, the more crazy it acts, and humanity starts acting really crazy. It's like the training exercise becomes more intense. The training exercise of trying to Spirit's trying to learn how to die, learn how to suffer death, an end. Spirit is trying to come to an end. So it uses these forms we call humanity. It uses these forms that it's imagining, simulating, to try and teach itself how to come to an end. So naturally, you've got to realize that a lot of forms will come to an end. They're ceaselessly coming to an end every instant on this planet. Trillions of things are coming to an end. You know, everything is falling apart. Pieces are coming off. Our skin is flaking off. Everything is disintegrating ceaselessly. So passing this information on is something that I came here to do, but it's probably why I don't have any friends. People automatically kind of get defensive around me because I must have something, give off some vibe, you know, that is saying, hey, I'm not here to inspire you. And people want to be inspired, right? We pretend we want to be inspired. But I'm saying it's impossible. Give it up. Give it up, Spirit. And if you have even one experience of being free of this flypaper, you won't forget it. You'll say, oh my gosh, what am I doing? You know, wow. But the mistake Spirit makes is it thinks that the way to get free is to inspire humanity. And then humanity will say, oh, we give you your freedom because we have now been lifted up too into Spirit. And so we make that mistake. We think we're supposed to inspire humanity. Look at all the efforts to inspire humanity throughout the ages. Go around and really look honestly at everyone you see today. Look at the world you see today. I was in a sports bar last night. We had a dinner watching the hockey game. First time I've ever done that. I watch a hockey game on high def TV. And we're looking around and it's just like the people in there say, oh my God, you know, so dispirited. There was one lady there that was so incredible, it was just noticeable. I mean, holy smokes. You know, you just say, holy, oh my God, you know, so dispirited. It was just like, I thought I was in a circus, you know. But is anywhere you go, you look, is anyone inspired? Just look, is anyone really inspired? If I don't know, if all these teachers in the world right now, I look at them and say, are they inspired? And I have to say, honestly, they're not. Knowing what the feeling of Spirit is, like that dream last night, I had this feeling. You look at the people in the world, they are not inspired. The great teachers, the great gurus, I look at them and say, yeah, they're inspired. They're inspired. Ramana Maharshi's inspired. He's in spirit. Ananda Maimonides, in spirit. Definitely. You can say that they're in spirit. You know it immediately. You say, ah, they're in spirit, and I'm stuck to this flypaper. But other people, you look around, they're not inspired. So you think, oh, Ramana, you're here to inspire us. No. The teachers come to tell you, give up your effort to inspire the flesh. The brain and the senses cannot possibly give you the experience of being in spirit. No way. No way ever. They are incredibly, incredibly limiting factors. They're not living. They themselves are decaying. They're just a device, a mechanical device. It's ludicrous to expect that. So we have a dispirited world. Humanity is dispirited. It's inherently dispirited, and it's not our job to spirit it at all. The idea that we're supposed to incarnate and gradually transform bodies so they become spirited is nonsense. Absolute nonsense. There's no need for that whatsoever. You can't do it anyway. Your spirit is spirit. It's not. And there's another thing. Again, like I said, spirit and flesh never meet, never touch, never. I think in the Sistine Chapel on the ceiling there's God and humanity, and they're not touching. See, they never touch. And like I said, God's not even or paying any attention to Spirit's training exercise. None. Doesn't judge it in the slightest bit. Total non-judgment on it. There's no judgment at all. Just no judgment. Says, Spirit, I know what you are, and I know how I created you, and I know you can't change what you are, so there's no point, no purpose to pay any attention at all to your attempts to change what you are, because I know it's simply you're doing nothing at all. You're doing nothing at all. So you can, it's possible to get into, to hear what's being said here, but then later in the day as you're working and doing things, you're like, forget. Of course, I said to Spirit, when I wake up in the morning, get up, I'll forget all this. So what good is it? Well, I'm trying not to forget. But as far as the experience goes, of course, it's back to being stuck in flypaper. But that could change. That's possible, it could change. So again, if you want to be in spirit, give up trying to inspire the flesh, to inspire humanity. Give it up. That's what they say. Relinquish the world. Set the world down. Detach from the world. Renounce the world. Give up your life. Jesus said he who would lose his life will gain his life. Meaning, he who stops trying to inspire the flesh will gain freedom from the flesh, freedom from that flypaper. Will be in spirit. And again, if you're even able to go with this and listen to it, you're actually very, 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 very advanced and actually very close to doing this. Because the vast majority of spirit is so into humanity in the flesh that they can't even remotely consider this type of sharing advice, not even remotely. And again, humanity didn't create itself, and humanity is actually nothing at all. These are just the flesh is really nothing. It's just training devices. It's like a bicycle, like a car, like an automobile that didn't make itself. And this automobile doesn't decide where it's driven to. An automobile will always be an automobile, you know. Humanity is simply a simulated training exercise. That's all it is. It is not some wonderful, special, marvelous thing. It is not spirit. It's not part of spirit. Again, imagination, spirit imagining itself that it's vulnerable to loss is not anything. It's simply dreaming about the impossible. That's another way to put it. Humanity is merely spirit dreaming about the impossible. And the feeling of being in spirit, it's not like you're a body. So you don't feel like you're dropping somewhere. It's just that you're space. You feel like you are one with this vast space. And you're just floating. Not even floating, because you don't have any density. You're just like an awareness in this vast space. There's no body to you at all. And it's you can't really put it into words. It's not quite an awareness. It's a livingness. It's a it's an experiencing. I looked out and I saw all these beautiful things and just wow. Beautiful heavenly things, as it were. Spirit, forms of spirit, or presentation of spirit. I'm seeing this beauty. And the depth to it, the depth to it, the freedom to it, the freedom from nature, the freedom from any, all of this loss and all this physics and all these principles and everything of the flesh. There's none of that there. It's fresh, it's completely clean. There's no vulnerability at all. And that's our natural, inescapable condition. So, the majority of humanity will continue to march on as a training exercise. The training exercise will continue on. Spirit will keep wanting to this training exercise, and will keep trying to inspire humanity to, as if humanity is some separate thing, it's a creation of spirit. And so spirit wants to inspire its creation. It's not a creation of spirit. It's an imagining of what can never be. That's not a creation. Okay, it's important. Humanity is not a creation. Spirit is acting like it is. That's why it's trying to inspire humanity. It's not a creation. It is an imagining. Spirit imagining it can do the impossible, and it cannot. So imagining that the impossible can be obtained is not a creation, because it's a nothing. It can never be. What can never be cannot be a creation. So a means to be what can never be is not a creation. Humanity is just a means to an end. The end can never be reached. It is not a creation. So see, spirit needs to stop pretending that humanity is a creation, that it's its creation. It's not a creation. Loss is not a creation. Vulnerability is not a creation. Time is not a creation. The past is not a creation. That is not creation at all. So spirit wanting to inspire humanity as like a child, trying to breathe life into humanity is impossible. You cannot breathe life into humanity. You cannot breathe life into an imaginary effort to accomplish the impossible. You cannot breathe life into symbols. It's all symbolic. Humanity is just symbolic. It's not a creation. So you can't breathe life into that. You can't inspire. You cannot put it in spirit. And so when spirit could finally let go of that effort and relinquish that effort, it's free. It's free, just like that. That's freedom. That is salvation. Salvation comes from relinquishing an effort, a futile effort. What else could it be? As long as we're engaged in a futile effort, I need to be saved from, I don't feel right, I'm stuck somehow. Of course, because being engaged in a futile effort is this feeling of being stuck, and we cry out for salvation. So relinquish that effort. Relinquish that effort, and then free of the flypaper. It's only our desire that keeps us that flypaper if we want to inspire humanity. Of course, we're trying to inspire humanity because we want this training exercise to continue. And we don't realize that it's our conflictual feelings that are playing out, spirit's conflictual feelings. We want it to continue so we can be prime creators. We haven't learned, we say, spirit says, we haven't learned how to annihilate ourselves yet, how to accept this. We haven't learned that. So we need humanity to continue. We need this training exercise to continue. On the same hand, spirit says, I'm so tired of this, I want to drop it. So then the spirit has this feeling like humanity wants to escape from it, you know. But humanity is neutral. It doesn't want to do anything at all. It's the same way that figures in a dream are neutral. They're not dreaming themselves. But spirit feels like humanity is trying to escape from spirit, and the spirit needs to keep it inspired. So spirit needs to keep trying to inspire humanity to continue to, you know, keep reproducing and keep this civilization, keep humanity going so it can use it, this training exercise. It's so spirit is conflicted about this whole training exercise, and it's not being honest with itself about what's going on. But when spirit can be honest with itself, then things start to resolve. I say, huh, okay, I see what I've been doing all along. I've been saved. I've been saved three times from really disillusion here, of giving up. First time was Jesus back in 1978. Second time was Ananda Mai Ma in 1997. Third time was Ramana Maharshi in 2001. And then the fourth time was last night, was Spirit itself. There was no form to the Spirit at all. It was just Spirit. It wasn't Spirit in the form of a teacher or anything like that. It was the actual experience of freedom. And I could see, oh, freedom is definitely possible. It's definitely possible. Again, Spirit needs to relinquish this training exercise, especially relinquish trying to inspire humanity. The human forms can remain, that's not a problem. Remember, it's Spirit that is giving them the purpose. They have no purpose of their own whatsoever. So when Spirit relinquishes trying to inspire humanity, trying to save humanity, inspire it, then Spirit is free of that, free of that limited perspective of the body, mind, the senses, free of that. It's not trying to teach itself anything. It's not trying to use humanity to teach it how to die. Again, that's what Spirit's doing. It's using humanity, the body, mind, the senses, and the experiencing of vulnerability of bodies to teach itself how to die. That's what is going on here. These videos are, I keep them going because this information is so difficult for any of us to consider. We need to stick with it. If it were simple, we would have got it a long time ago. I mean, if it were easy for us to accept it. Our spirit is all caught up in this pride of, no, I can become prime creator. I started this, I can finish. There must be a way, I can find a way. And so it instills this so-called pride in humanity. But again, humanity is neutral. Bodies are neutral. But spirit projects into these bodies its pride and saying, no, we can do it. We can be inspired enough to learn how to annihilate ourselves. And spirit feels like incompetent that it can't do this. It's thinking like, wow, how come I can't learn this? Because Spirit didn't create itself. That's why. What God created is inviolate. It is endless. It's eternal. It's God's will. It cannot be changed. So Spirit's kind of all depressed, like, oh, I can't teach myself how to be annihilated. And it keeps trying and trying and trying. Very prideful. It's kind of embarrassed that it can't do it. But again, God is not judging these efforts at all. He's paying no attention to the efforts. Yeah, so it is worth noting that this freedom can be experienced. I experienced it in a dream just this last night. It was a night here going in the morning of the 27th, actually. Of May 2013, and was very much aware of getting free of this flypaper of humanity, and looking down, as it were, upon humanity from spirit, and then asking, how do I stay unstuck, and all this kind of stuff. Humanity can act extraordinarily strange, but again, it's only spirit projecting onto humanity that causes all the things that happen to humanity. If spirit is not projecting anything on a human body, the human body will sit there inert, like Ananda Mai Ma. She would sit there like an absolute statue. The body, like a frozen stone statue. If nobody asked her to teach or to, you know, for clarification, that's what the body would be like. And she says, I have nothing is coming from the body to, needs of the body to get me to do something at all. None. Again, everything that the body does is projected upon it by spirit. Everything. Without any projections from spirit, the body is inert. That's why those gurus can go into this inert condition of the body, samadhi. They withdraw all projections from upon the body. The body of itself is inert, it's neutral. This is something that spirit doesn't like to understand. It doesn't like that, to hear that, that it's projecting. Because it wants the body to have some power beyond that of spirit. In other words, a power to teach spirit something that spirit knows that it itself cannot learn. So it has this dream that the body is something different, is some magical, mystical something that has some magical, mystical power to teach spirit what is impossible for spirit to learn, which is how to die, how to be annihilated. So spirit doesn't want to realize that it's projecting everything upon the body. It wants to say, no, the body has some intrinsic nature of its own. And that this intrinsic nature of its own doesn't come from anywhere, from God, from spirit, anywhere. It comes from the body. And therefore the body can do the impossible. It can teach spirit. That's what spirit has to believe. It keeps believing that. That it's not true. It is not true. Of course, all these projections are bouncing around and get habit and momentum and continuity, all this stuff. So it seems as though bodies have characteristics and everything like that. But everything is projected by spirit, everything. Just like a dreamer is dreaming all of the dream, not part of it, all of it. And yet within the dream, how the dream figures interact, the dream figures are oblivious to the fact that they're being dreamed. It's the same way with the human bodies. Everyone pretends to be oblivious to the fact that everything they're doing, everything is just a projection by spirit. The bodies are just acting out the play that spirit is producing, as it were. It's mind is producing it for spirit. Mind is the producer. But it's spirit is the one that is choosing the idea, and it has a desire to experience this idea. So the desire comes from spirit. The production itself, mind presents presenting it, but it's the production. The desire comes from spirit. So you could say that it is, mind is projecting all this on behalf of spirit. But we can shorthand it to spirit, just say spirit is projecting all this. Again, spirit refuses to accept this because that would mean that the body doesn't have any special magic for spirit. And then spirit can't teach itself how to be annihilated, which means spirit cannot be prime creator. So spirit doesn't want to give this dream up of being prime creator. So it insists that body has some specialness to it, that is coming someplace other than spirit, from some other source. And then therefore, and that spirit needs to inspire body to continue on with this source, like it's trying to bring this source out of body. When we say that spirit is trying to inspire the flesh, it thinks the flesh has some special characteristic which will enable spirit to be annihilated, learn how to be annihilated, and then be resurrected. So it's trying to inspire flesh to give up the secret, to release the secret to spirit. So spirit is thinking, it says, I just got to inspire it more. I just need to inspire humanity because humanity is great. Spirit will say, humanity has this greatness within it. I just know. If I just inspire it, I can bring this greatness out. That is the game that spirit's playing. There is no greatness to humanity. There is no hidden characteristic. There is no magic. It doesn't, none at all. But spirit wants there to be. It wants, so it imagines it's there, even though it's not. So you might say spirit is searching for what is not there. It's like spirit hides itself within humanity, so to speak, and then pretends that it doesn't know what's there, And it's not what spirit, and then it's searching for itself, really, thinking, oh, there's some special characteristic there, hide and seek. But there, humanity has no characteristic at all, special characteristic. No magic for spirit, none. There is no magic for spirit to learn how to die. No magic for spirit to learn how to die. There is none. Let's say for a parable that someone has a golden ring, spirit has a golden ring, and it throws it into the world and it pretends it's lost. It says, where is it? Where is it? Where is it? And then it says, oh, there's something very valuable in the world and humanity. I need to find it. So it goes on a search, trying to find it, thinking that it belongs to humanity. But it's really just spirit's golden ring that spirit is pretending to have lost. So in other words, the spirit is searching for itself, pretending that itself is something else. It's not. But in this pretense, it can imagine, oh, I'm searching for some special characteristic, which is going to enable me to do the impossible, to overthrow God's will, and change what I am. In fact, annihilate myself so that I can be resurrected. So again, it's spirit that has this overblown notion of humanity. It's not humanity. Humanity is inert. It has no characteristics of its own. It's all projected by spirit. So all this pride in humanity, this pride and everything, that comes from spirit, that spiritual pride. It's a projection of spirit saying, I can do this. I know the way to be annihilated. I can do this. I will create a special force, a training program that has special characteristics that will succeed. No, you can have bodies die forever and never succeed in teaching spirit anything. So this is all something that is causing, you know, your spirit to like go, ooh, 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 like, whoa, this is different. That's kind of like a feeling like, oh, I'm almost free of the fly paper. A fly is trying to get free of that fly paper. And it's like, oh, I'm almost free of it. You know, like, wow, what's going on? But again, it's important to do this now because the training exercise that spirit is projecting upon humanity, for humanity to act out. And again, humanity has no capacity of its own to withstand these projections. Humanity is neutral. It's inert. It's nothing. It's a dream figure. So it doesn't have any way to prevent spirit's projections at all. None whatsoever. Just like a dream figure doesn't have any way to prevent the manipulation of the dream figure in a dream. The dreamer manipulates it the way it wants to. So spirit's pride is what activates humanity, and everything that happens here is from the pride of spirit, spiritual pride, in attempting to change what it is. Everything, as far as humanity goes. It's not humanity. Humanity is doing nothing. But spirit pretends that humanity is its own actor, something. It's not. It's like a marionette. It's like a puppet. You can make a puppet marionette do all sorts of stuff, but marionette is not doing anything. So again, the whole situation is spiritual pride. Spirit trying to teach itself an impossible lesson, a lesson it can never learn. And trying to inspire humanity. It's really trying to inspire itself, if you really look at it. Spirit is trying to inspire itself to learn how to be annihilated. And so all spirit has to do is give up this effort to inspire itself to be annihilated. And then it's free again. It can experience its freedom. What it is, it'll experience what it is. Of course, if spirit is intent on annihilating itself, it's not going to be experiencing its perfect freedom and safety. It will not. It will be as it is, stuck to some flat, plain tar paper, fly paper, feeling completely claustrophobic and suffocated. It was in just flatness, total flatness, this feeling of totally flatness, no real depth of experiencing at all. We will feel stuck, and that's what's happening. We're trying to inspire ourselves to learn how to annihilate ourselves. And again, humanity is just a gym where we have these exercise bicycles, where we engage in these training exercises. It is neutral. It doesn't have any purpose of its own whatsoever. So looking at it this way is practicing spiritual honesty, and that's what gets you free. Spirit admitting what it's been trying to do is called repentance. Repentance is not humanity, it's not a human being repenting, it is spirit repenting. Human beings are neutral, they don't have again. They're nothing. It's spirit repents. It says, you know what? I see what I've been trying to do. I see why I felt stuck. I see the whole situation easy, simple. I can stop trying to inspire myself. And of course, Spirit claims that God gave it some special gift to inspire this to succeed. No, God did not. God did not give Spirit some special dispensation to annihilate itself. But of course, Spirit claims this. It claims the whole thing sponsored by God. It says, no, God, this is all God's work. That this training exercise is God set it up for me so I can learn how to die and then be resurrected from the dead like that. No, God did no such thing. No such thing. Spirit is just pulling the rabbit out of a hat, trying to keep itself inspired. It's becoming, Spirit says, oh, I want to give this up. But then it says, no, God did all this, so it must be a way, right? Because if God did set it all up, then there must be a way, right? That is true, if God set it up. But God did not set it up. So again, Spirit tries to keep its inspiration going to accomplish the impossible by claiming that God set it all up and therefore it must succeed and it must continue on. There's got to be a way. There's no way. God did not set it up. God did not set up some way for Spirit to annihilate itself. Absolutely not. In spite of the stories that have been told in historical stories, and Spirit even claims exactly that no, God set this whole thing up, showed us that His Son can die, and then after His Son dying, it's resurrected, it's a new Spirit, etc., etc. This is all projection of Spirit, just a projection of Spirit claiming these things. That's how Spirit motivates itself, to keep going, to keep trying. And which is why we're still so stuck, because Spirit has told itself these tall tales of motivation, as if God is somehow involved in this. It's not. God is not involved in these undertakings at all. God simply says, Spirit, you are still exactly as I created you, and you always will be. End of story. No worries. That's it. No judgment upon what Spirit's doing. Nothing like that. So again, Spirit will project these scenarios into the world, claiming that God is set this whole up and is on board with this plan, and that God, there's a way for the Son of God, Spirit, to die, and supposedly God will, you know, kill the Son, or make the Son flesh, and then the flesh can be killed. And then after the Son of God, the Spirit, is killed, then it resurrects from the dead as a new eternal Spirit. Something Spirit can project this belief scenario into humanity, etc., and claim that this is proof that God's on board with all this. But again, it's all Spirit projecting its own desires. That comes from spiritual pride. It doesn't come from God. And this is something that Spirit is clinging to, saying, no, there is a way. So into this vast cauldron of spiritual pride, truth has to emerge at some point. And, of course, spiritual pride doesn't like being told it can't do something. But again, it's God that is telling spirit that it cannot annihilate itself. It's not spirit. It passes on the truth here. It's passing on the truth from God. The Holy Spirit is passing on the truth from God to spirit. Okay, and then those who accept this, those spirits who accept this, pass it on to other spirits, saying, "Hey, this is what the Holy Spirit has told us, and it comes from God. That God is not involved in any of this. It's only spiritual pride that's at work here, because spirit wants to be prime creator, wants to displace God, and therefore wants to change what it is, get rid of what it is, and be reborn as a new spirit." So the dream I had last night was very, very significant, because it shows that this is on the right track. This is on the right track. I felt the liberation. I experienced it. Experienced a liberation. You can call it a salvation. From being stuck in this flypaper of spiritual pride, of trying to inspire spirit, trying to inspire itself to accomplish the impossible. It gives it this feeling of stuckness. I experienced being unstuck from it, unstuck from it. And then today is just a normal day. Nothing different and unusual about the day at all, except I'm able to pass on this more adamant teaching here. We'll see how I feel about it later on when I say, spiritual pride isn't going to like this. Of course not. But for those who have too much spiritual pride, they shouldn't be listening to it, really. You can always stop listening to it. And again, it's not what I say. This is being passed on from the Holy Spirit. That's the teaching I got in spirit. My fellow's coming from the Holy Spirit, telling me this is what's going on. Did say that it's very helpful to distance yourself from this scenario, which is why I believe that there's going to be some relocation take place. I asked, what can we do? Because there's such this incredible pull, pride, and the Holy Spirit says, get opposite, distance yourself from it so you don't even hear it, hardly can hear it. And then you will easily settle down and awaken. So there's probably going to be a relocation. It's something I've always preached. The intensity of the training exercise, the intensity of spiritual pride right now is at an all-time high. And it's getting exponentially higher all the time. And this is a very, very bad thing, because it tends to entrain us all into that pride, that spiritual pride, which is our downfall. That's how we get stuck. So much spiritual pride in the world right now. It is simply incredible. So, again, I gave a date, June 30th. That's 6:30. I think I had another video. I haven't posted it yet. Maybe I'll post it. Maybe I won't. Maybe I'll just do it right here. The night before last, I had a dream in which I was given a date, finally. And I was told at 6:30 to 13, this June 30th, help would arrive. Help would arrive. It was in the form of this airplane. So I wonder if there isn't going to be some sort of beginning of some relocation take place at that point. 6:30, June 30th, which is about 34 days away now. And in the dream, I just had to wait. I realized I just have to wait until this date. But at this date, there's going to be relief. Something is coming in. Spirit is going to come in. This idea of an airplane coming down from the sky and landing was like spirit is Holy Spirit is coming in to help those aspects of spirit who want to drop their spiritual pride. And so something very helpful, relief is on its way, is what I was given. Relief is on its way. It's only about 34 days away. And interestingly enough, there's the sound of an airplane up there right now. Amazing how that happens. So do not buckle at this time. Do not buckle under. In fact, feel confident. Feel confident that you are going to, somehow, relief will come in the form of getting some distance from this he chant. This chant of, oh, we're being so inspired, oh, we're being so inspired, oh, we're being... See, spirit will think, oh my gosh, there is some inspiration, it's really working, and get sucked into it. Now, there's no inspiration working at all. But this chant, the drum beats, and all the people dancing like a carnival, like, oh, we're so inspired, look, we're so ecstatic, et cetera, et cetera. I came across a very important saying last night. I was watching that video I made about Ramana Maharshi, the teachings of Ramana Maharshi. And on that, one of the sayings was, you need to go beyond the state of ecstasy to the great calm. He says, the great calm is higher. That is the true goal. Ah, very important. Because this ecstasy can be claimed to be inspiration of how to accomplish the impossible. Like people will say, we're being inspired. He is inspiring us. God is inspiring us. We're being inspired. We're on fire with inspiration. That's, Rana said, and that's not it. He said, the great calm is it. The great calm is it. Same thing with Anandamayi Mata. Early on, she was in all these ecstatic states, showing people all these different ecstatic states. And then later, she went into this great calm. She says, beyond all these ecstatic states is this great calm. It's this great peace. It's this great calm. This great calm spaciousness, which is the goal. It's not all these ecstatic states. But people wanted to see those, so they acted out through her, as it were. But no, it's the great calm. So again, this relocation that I sense is coming is a way to get away from all the ecstasy of imagined inspiration with the planet saying, oh, we're being so inspired, humanity. Oh, finally, he's inspiring us. We're being inspired in all this acting out of ecstasy or something, where we can get into the true great calm of spirit, the vastness, which is undisturbed vastness of spiritual, true spiritual life, has this unperturbed calmness about it. Peace beyond understanding, as Jesus said. Peace beyond understanding. So again, there is this date. I was finally given this date. 6:30. I mean, to me, that's a date. It's not a time when you have a dream like that. It's telling you on the calendar, 6:30. The plane was supposed to come at 6:30. Well, that's 6:30, meaning June 30th. And hopefully we'll get a distancing from what's going to happen with humanity, claiming a great inspiration, perhaps. We don't need a great inspiration. We are already our spirit. We need to stop trying to inspire ourselves. Spirit doesn't need to inspire itself. It already is what it is. Any efforts of spirit to inspire itself are really attempts to inspire itself to accomplish the impossible, to change what it is. So what we really need is just to experience what we are, which is this great calm, this great peace, this great stability, perfect stability, etc. We already are that. We don't need to inspire. Inspiration, again, is pride, spiritual pride. Spirit doesn't need to be, God doesn't inspire spirit to be what it is. God created spirit what it is. Creation is perfect. What need is there for inspiration? Spirit is functioning perfectly as God created it. So trying to inspire itself is spiritual pride. So what I'm trying to do here is inform. It's different. I'm not one of these ecstasy, ecstatic gurus, you know, just going out, you know, trying to inspire people. No, it's very drab, it's very dull here, right? As far as inspirational qualities go, it's sharing truth that we don't need inspiration. Spirit doesn't need inspiration. We think, oh, if we drop inspiration, we'll be dispirited. No, we'll be what we are, already are. We'll be as God created us. We don't need to be inspired to be what we are. We already are what we are. Inspiration is spiritual pride, trying to get us to accomplish something, trying to get us to accomplish our own annihilation, something that God did not create us, trying to change what God created. That's spiritual pride. And of course we need to be inspired to try to inspire ourselves to do something that can't be done. Drop the inspiration, drop the effort of inspiration, drop the effort of inspiration and abide as you are, as you already are. All right. As Ramana said, abide as the self. Abide as you already are. You don't need any inspiration to be what you are. He's, right? And he wasn't going out there trying to whip people into ecstasy. He's just sitting there quietly, saying nothing, just abiding as he is. That's the truth. That is the truth. So relief is on its way. Continue to expand your awareness, expand your understanding, expand your clarity, so that these concepts that are being shared are not foreign to you. They're not alien to you. You say, I've heard this before. Yeah, I'm kind of used to that. My nerves are, I'm kind of settled to it. I'm not all jittery about it. And then it'll be easy. It'll be very easy. And for those who have no familiarity with it, you know, forget it. They'll say, what? You're trying to do something terrible. You're trying to dispirit us. We want inspiration. We need inspiration. We're looking for sources of inspiration. And you say, no, that's not it. All right. So we'll see how this goes down. Hopefully it won't give you an upset stomach, but it might give you a little bit of turbulence. All right, that's it.